me your name, please?
Annika.
Cool.
Thank you for all the great words you've said so far. So my question is, everybody wants to call themselves an activist. We see students out there every color protesting, but what's the next step to take, no matter what you classify yourself as, to become not just an ally, but to become one with the movement? What do you do to go beyond just protesting?
A lot. I know. But I'm just reaching out to my comrade to see if she wants to say something before she got to leave. Did you want to expound on that? It'll be helpful.
Sure.
Sorry to put you on the spot.
Can you get up so people can hear?
Or just yell out however you want to do it.
Yeah, so I'm Vanessa, and I'm one of the organizers with BLM 413, the local chapter of Black Lives Matter that was formed after this trip to Ferguson. I think in what Chris just spoke about, I feel like that was kind of touched on, but I think, I guess I briefly talk about like the importance of this movement being not only primarily black led, but the term Black Lives Matter was started by three black women, so also by young black and brown women. And for some of us who face police violence every day, the one statistic that I always throw out that I'll mention again right now was that every 28 hours a black person was killed by police or vigilantes in the United States. But as of yesterday, and I'm not sure how many of these people were white and how many of them were black, 109 people had been killed in this country by police as of yesterday for the year. So I have a feeling that statistic has gone up a lot this year. So I don't even know actually what this term like activist like means anymore. Like, I like the term organizer because like, what was just spoken about in the movement being decentralized, I think is really important, and nobody's looking to kind of one leader. People are organizing together and people are building together. So, I don't know. I think like, again, I would say that like a lot of people don't, I guess everyone does like have a choice. Like black people can like lock themselves in their house forever or choose to go out and live. And if you choose to go out and live, I think for a majority of black and brown people, that means fighting back. So I will say that. I will also use this time very briefly to encourage you all to check out the Black Lives Matter 413 Facebook page because that's a really good way to stay connected with what we're doing. And the local chapter is predominantly black and brown people. It's all black and brown people who are leading the movement and very intentionally reaching out to what we want our help to look like from white allies and putting a lot of thought and having a lot of conversation about what white allyship looks like to this movement, to us locally, because it's really important that the people who are most affected by these issues, not just of being shot every day, but of mass incarceration, but of the violence of poverty, but of the violence of discrimination and inadequate education and constant policing in every level of education from the time children enter school. We're thinking about all of those things, and we're going to have a different response. So I would encourage everyone to check out the BLM 413 Facebook page, and also say that this Friday, several of us who went to Ferguson, young black organizers, are doing a panel at Hampshire from 3 to 5 p.m., and you're all welcome to come to that and continue the conversation. And I will also throw out a little kind of save the date, because the 21st this year is 50 years since Malcolm X was assassinated, and we're going to be having a major action there. And so all color allies and organizers and activists and revolutionaries are welcome to come, and artists and humans are welcome to come and support at this time. There will be information closer to the date.
Got hot in here. Go ahead.
I was moved by a lot of what you said, and I've been thinking a lot about what you've said about history. And I'm wondering whether you could talk more about what you see as the significance of shifting from Black History Month to Black Teachers Month, and how that relates to what I see as a really powerful, so you're poking at the narrative of progress. You're doing it in a very powerful way of asking us instead to make these traumatic, right, connections to the past, right, and the bowel of the slave ship. So I'm wondering if you can talk more about what you see as the role of history in our thinking about struggle, and how to conceptualize that in ways that don't create false narratives of progress, but also don't kind of make history meaningless.
Right. I think history is one of my favorite weapons, but that's because I'm under the tutelage of, people like John Bracey and Ernest Allen, Mike Delwell, and many others directly connected to movement in their day. And during the repression of Black activism, Black radical activism in the 60s and 70s, the refuge was universities for a lot of folks. But they brought all that movement memory to the spaces of the academy, and then began to identify the academy as a site of contestation, as a site to struggle against, not just be a part of. So I'm in that tradition. And then intellectually, people from Walter Rodney, James, as I mentioned, and many others remind us of the importance of history in social struggle. And again, they're criminalized for it. So it comes with great risk. I've said before that I'm not sure that you can call yourself an activist unless you have committed to learning the history of that which you're organizing around. Many people just sign up for something, but they don't want to learn the history of what it is they're organizing around, or they're in it for themselves. And so rather than committing themselves to a deep, broad understanding of how we got to this moment, it's more about self-reference and pleasure and thrill-seeking and things of that nature. So I want to poke at that and name that. But I also want to talk specifically briefly about just some of the historic issues that come up for those of us who do study history that make Ferguson what Ferguson is. And one of the things that is not talked about very often is the history of racial and educational segregation in Ferguson as a part of government policy in the 1950s to suburbanize certain parts of Missouri. And this happened across the country. But St. Louis also has a particular history of that, and also a particular history of not only suburbanization, but suburbanization at the expense of the ghetto. And that is to say, not only were ghettos left behind, people in them left behind, but in many cases, public housing was absolutely demolished, left to deteriorate in St. Louis. So when we think about the history that Mike Brown walked into, it's a history that includes zoning and redlining and restrictive covenants and things that worry the hell out of historians, because now we got to go and read all those mortgages. But the point is that that's part of the entanglement, if you will, the historical entanglement that led to Ferguson being most recently that part heavily occupied by Black working class people. This has everything to do with suburbanization, patterns of suburbanization throughout Missouri. And because you have that residential segregation, you're going to have educational segregation, both in terms of monies allocated to schools and also who attends the public schools. And obviously, as we know throughout the country, if you are in a wealthy district of homeowners, that local school is going to be better funded than the one that gets most of its money from the state. And so that's the pattern in Springfield, that's the pattern in Holyoke, those are the patterns of urban America. And so in many respects, this is a historic question of urban America, urbanization, and racial segregation through housing and economic policy, you know. So in terms of just things that we could study, it's certainly ample, there's ample evidence there to show the kind of historic background, the soil ingredients, whatever you want to call it, that led to an all-white police force policing a pretty much black community. But that 15 years ago, that same community had a lot of working class white people there. So, you know, this is part of the patterns in American society, but urbanization and suburbanization are definitely part of it.
Movement that is predominantly youth-led. Like, we see this as not like some new revolution or some new struggle for black liberation, but the continuum that you mentioned, but a continuing and a picking up of resistance and struggle for over 500 years of colonial-like structures. So it's nothing new. So we read Asada and we study Nat Turner as excitedly as we listen to Tef Poe's new music and connect with the Dream Defenders. So I would say that.
Yeah. You know, push the professor on these questions, you know, of redlining, zoning, housing segregation, deteriorating public housing. That's part of what made St. Louis St. Louis. You know, and also, you know, parts of Massachusetts, Lowell, you know, Holyoke, as I mentioned. I mean, all cities are not immune to this. This is a pattern in American society. Mm-hmm. Anyone over here? Oh, hey, what's up?
I have a question. I know that a lot of times, you know, there's the phenomenon where something happens and then you start hearing about all these other cases of this similar thing happening. And I hear the once every 28 hours, a person of color is killed by somebody. And also what was said today that, you know, maybe that number is going up. Does that seem like it's, is that happening more? Are we hearing about it more? What do you think's going on there? Do you have any thoughts on that? Like, were people of color being targeted and just killed as with as much impudence in the 90s?
Yes.
And so are we just hearing about it more? And it was, but it's been happening at the same rate?
Yeah, different. I don't know about the same rate because that number refers to what's happened since 2010. This is
right.
Coming out from the Malcolm X grassroots movement,
right,
who gave that language to the movement of every 28 hours. That's coming from MXG, and that's a recent study.
Right.
And it's not longitudinal in the sense that it doesn't go back into the 70s and look at the period that way. So I don't want to say every 28 hours was happening in the 90s. Doesn't mean, though, that aggressive policing and jailing and sentencing patterns hadn't been meted out, you know, across the urban landscape with veracity in the 1980s and 90s. I'm from Los Angeles. The battle ram, you know, as a part of the war on drugs. This was a literal one-man vehicle that could drive up on any surface and had a, you know, elongated arm that literally ran up in houses. So when we're talking about militarism, we're talking about the carceral continuum, we're talking about exposure to violence, we're talking about hyper-visibility, racialization by the police, that is nothing new.
Sure.
What we're talking about now is also a part of kind of a reorganizing of the state such that black lives are being rendered, again, disposable property. And so, you know, instead of going through the gamut of things that you could do to say, either in confrontation, protect yourself, or in the 90s, there were fist fights with police, that was regular. Now it's just, we're gonna shoot you. And so it's part of a long history of violence that black bodies have suffered in this country since the beginning, arguably.
Right.
you know, so.
I feel like when you hear names like, you know, Amadou Diallo, or, you know, like over the years, you hear names every now and then, but now it's like, it's a name like every day.
But that's.
I mean, just because we didn't know about it doesn't mean it wasn't happening.
That's when, yeah.
And every single community has these stories.
Yeah.
Of you know, people's lives lost in police custody, or shot by police in a normal, otherwise normal traffic stop. Even police, I'm just learning those stories locally, of police inciting riots, and then, you know, criminalizing everybody in their neighborhood for attacking the police. And I use that term riot because it is a police riot, even though they use our rebellions, they use that as a riot. But I'm saying, you know, folks provoking. There's never been a time, to my knowledge, where broad-based transparency in terms of how community and police respond to one another and how police, you know, make themselves available, transparent, that's been the rule. You know, it's always been an exception. And so growing up, that was our circumstance. A regular traffic stop could end up in cuffs in the back of the car. You did nothing wrong. All those things are part of this carceral continuum. And folks have shown that the more negative interactions you have with police, the less civically engaged you're going to be. And so that correlation is indisputable at any given time.
Well, my way, my name is Khalil. And I hear your statement about, like, it's going on and on and on and on. I think it has never stopped since lynching. I mean, the method has to change. I mean, when they lynched us, left us out there for hours to instill that fear. And you look at what happened with Mike Brown, yeah, being left out there for 4.5 hours. And then being put in the back of a pickup truck, you know, couldn't even have the honors enough to get an ambulance.
Right.
You know, so it's social media has been playing a big role in, like, how we are able to project our own media, you know, and share it. You know, so that's why we hear a lot more, especially if you're on any kind of social media. It's real big. And I just wanted to, like, touch on, like, you know, what the young lady was saying about, like, how can we get involved, and it's sad to say, but like silence is violence. And like getting involved, it's like you have to find your role, you know. Literally, you gotta ask yourself, which side are you on?
Right.
You know, because if you're not doing anything, then you're actually part of that problem. You know, so finding your role in this, you know, is major. And I'd like to just thank you for everything that you share, because the reality of freedom is that I strongly believe that once black people are free, that all people will be free. You know, I come to the sense where sometimes I feel like Jesus must have been black, because he was oppressed like none other, you know? And so it's something that's continuously going on, and finding your role. And there is, even though BLM 413 is, you know, a black movement by black youth, there is a coalition that is starting. And I have an email for people that want to get involved that are white allies. So I'll kind of share that now. It's TIW Solidarity Looks Like 413 at gmail.com. And it's a beautiful sister named Rachel, who's kind of put this coalition together to kind of have those engagements of, like, what does white allies look like?
Tison.
You mean the email again? TIW, all caps, Solidarity Looks Like 413 at gmail.com. Oh, Rachel, Rubens. That's Rubens' people.
Yeah.
gmail.com. So there's
you send it to them and then run it away.
I also want you to put in your notes to go to the Organization for Black Struggle website, OBS-on-the-move, constantly updated, and so that you can read the concrete demands of the movement, because BLM, Black Lives Matter, is giving us the general soul and context of what's being called for and the new vision, but there's some on-the-ground things that are happening in Ferguson that we need to know about And this organization is literally at the heart of it. OBS, Organization for Black Struggle, OBS-onthemove.org. All right, so make sure you check that out. There's constant updates. You can get links to that. You can hear our show Friday, 6 o'clock here at WMUA, streaming live on the internet as well, WMUA.org. But this is a movement that we have to make sure we really deeply understand and develop affinity with and join if it's for you. But know that if you hate, you're gonna get rolled on. So as long as you know that, because this, you know, we're not stopping. This movement is about our lives, and anybody who wants to disrespect that or discredit that, that's when you're gonna bring out a different side of these people. You know what I'm saying? Of us. Always nonviolent, but always aggressive. I shouldn't say always nonviolent. We might have to, you know, show a little strength, but it's all good. Anyway, I enjoyed being with you today. And I'm at Doc10 on Twitter, DAHKTIN. You can also email ctinson@hampshire.edu. It's been a pleasure. Let's keep the movement moving.
He is widely published. His articles have appeared in The Black Scholar, The Journal of African American History, The Nation, and Radical Teacher. I also am just delighted to say that he's a very engaged scholar. He's not the kind of person who just kind of sits in a library and publishes for, you know, small audiences. You know, not only with his articles in venues like The Nation, but also his very active speaking career. So he goes around, he accepts a lot of speaking engagements, which is extraordinarily labor intensive, but it's so important for all of us to hear what he has to say on these important topics. And he also, many of you probably know, hosts a radio program, Trigger Radio, which is a hip hop rooted social justice program on the radio. So if you haven't already heard it, tune in. I'm not going to say more because obviously you've come to hear him and not me, but I'll just ask you to give him a warm round of applause.
Thank you all. Can everybody hear me in the back?
Yeah.
You want me to yell?
Yes.
Okay. So I prepared a talk only so that I can make sure I stay on target with the goals of time and understanding in equal measure. I appreciate you for being here. I want to thank my hosts, Commonwealth College, as well as STEBIC, and of course UMass, which is, you know, one of my alma maters, which I definitely keep near and dear in my heart. And how many of y'all take Africana studies or African American studies classes? All right, I'm glad y'all are here regardless. It's only five people, for all my people who didn't see. Oh, my bad, seven. So what I want to do today is, this is not going to be a history of Ferguson as such, but more or less a discussion about what I believe and what I read as Ferguson's relevance for our contemporary struggle for social justice and what it means for the state of people of African descent, black and brown people. And give us a sense of where things are right now, both in Ferguson and also just in, you know, hot spots around the country as it relates to racial justice and the ability to move freely. And if you see today's title, Black Impossibility, Ferguson and the Persistent Indictment of American Society, what I want to do is try to frame this in a historical context of resistance, black radical resistance. So those are some of the objectives that I have for today. And then, of course, at the end, I want to make sure that there's enough time so that there's anything on your heart and mind that you want to share with us or ask about, then we definitely want to try to get that addressed, okay? I had the great fortune of being amongst a small delegate of folks from Western Mass who traveled down to Ferguson, Missouri in October of 2014. And this is not to take you there in a voyeuristic sense, but only to emphasize that Ferguson is the epicenter of what I'm calling a new era of justice-seeking activity. And even though it's not in the mainstream media, there's still an effort going on in Ferguson, a people's movement in Ferguson for justice. And so we're gonna touch on that throughout our time together today. Is that cool with everybody? Y'all good with that? Is everybody in here Commonwealth College folks? No? How many people are Commonwealth College? All right. Legally? All right, just making sure. So I was blown away just a minute ago because my good brother Mazin gave me some info on the shooting deaths of three Muslim, young Muslim folks in North Carolina this morning. And you see here, Stolen Lives, this is a project that's been going on for decades now, just calculating all the names. And so I'd be remiss if in this era or in this moment that we're in right now, talking about black and brown lives and miss what just happened this morning. And it should also give a sense of the continuation of racial hostility and racial injustice that is part and parcel of American society. So what we want to understand is not only how we got to that point, but what the hell we do about it. Many of us as young people starting out in activism, that's the main question is, you know, we need to do something, well, what do we do? And many people in Ferguson have given us ample understanding of what needs to happen, and also around the country as well. So I wanna make sure that we, did folks know about this case in North Carolina? Mm-hmm. Heard about it? I was the only person. I was getting ready for y'all, so I didn't read the news this morning. But I just want to bring their names, their energy, their being into this space. Dia, Barikat, Razal, and Yusur Muhammad Abu Salha, along with the names of Tamir Rice, Rakia Boyd, Renisha McBride, Trayvon Martin, Azelle Ford, Kendrick McDade, Sean Bell, Troy Davis, Kajime Powell, Eric Garner, Jordan Davis, Bo Morrison, Von Derrick Myers, Yvette Henderson, Ladarius Williams. That's just some of the names that we should remember as we learn about what's happening in this country. And arguably, this is what captivity means. One of the things that I study and that I try to do in my work is show the kind of historic patterns of racial injustice, which is a friendly way of talking about racial violence that has been part of the fabric of the United States, if not modernity in general, for as long as we can remember. And the fact that we're still stuck in that kind of violent, anti-black in many respects, anti-brown kind of space should give us alarm, make us stop and wonder what the hell is going on. And even though it might not be a UMass student or a Hampshire student, it's a student. The names that we mentioned earlier, many of those folks are young people. Many of those people have families in this country and around the world. And it should just make us think about what this means. Is this a declaration of war? Is this some kind of assault on black and brown life? Is it systemic? Are these rotten apples? Are these random occurrences? And I would argue that they are. So what I'm going to read and talk to you about is about this kind of mess that we've gotten ourselves in. And I use the term black impossibility Because really, we're running out of vocabulary to describe what's happening. So what I'm gonna say spins off of a lot that has been talked about with my own flavor and understanding, historical understanding, and commitments as a radical intellectual. And I make no bones about that because I believe that it's important for intellectuals, so-called intellectuals, scholars, people in academy, to engage themselves fully in the work of racial justice. And that's a standard that I hold myself to. And I'm inviting you into that discussion as well. In a recent conversation, social theorist Joy James and philosopher George Yancey contextualized the current moment as one locked between grief and action. It is this sense of intense worry and the energy of activism that helps us measure, or at least frame for tonight, what I'm calling Black impossibility. Joy James puts the matter squarely. She says, the implications of public servants and deputized vigilantes violating Black life with impunity are profound, especially for people of color, especially for young Black people. We need to publicly debate whether it is just, moral, appropriate, or even safe and sane to believe in modern policing, given the corruption and danger present in the institution. Police agencies have a history of racial bias and violence that has been investigated and condemned by governments as well as civil and human rights organizations. Citizens are supposed to flee or fight criminals, not the police. But reality teaches you that in Black life, you need to be ever vigilant for both. A question we might begin with is, what happens when the term white supremacy enters into mainstream discourse as the central target of this our movement? What changes for us when we consider that George Zimmerman walked, Darren Wilson got off and got paid, and no charges brought against the NYPD stranglers of Eric Garner, and imagine ourselves living as so-called citizens? What does it mean when Black and citizen are incompatible terms? Zimmerman, Wilson, the NYPD stranglers, the police union bully representatives are not heroes, but are the faces of institutional logics that have rendered Black lives perpetually disposable. Make no mistake about it, no amount of Black successes can discount the hard, bloody deaths too many Black lives have suffered. Impossibility, therefore, refers to the reproduction of limitations that govern Black life chances, that mark Black experience as persistently under threat, the historical and global performance of capitalist, military, penal democracies' insatiable appetite for anti-Blackness. Joy James is on point when she remarks whether it is sane to trust these systems. Yet their power to extract life from African descendants of varying ages and hues remains. Each killing of an unarmed Black and brown life at the hands of a policing agency or carceral institution adds to the list of indictments leveled at civil society. The acceleration of death represents what scholar revolutionary Frank Wilderson calls a carceral continuum, wherein the ability of living, breathing, being while Black is measured by one's proximity and exposure to state aggression, often of the most violent variety. It's a continuum that links 14-year-old George Stinney to Oscar Grant, Troy Davis to Asada Shakur, Mumia Abu-Jamal to Von Derrick Myers, Tukey Williams to Tamir Rice. Black impossibility, therefore, represents nothing short of the carceral continuity of Black life. civil society that is lawmaking and ostensibly law-abiding has historically upheld a logic that linked blackness with poverty, ghettos, inadequate housing, and poor education. That these have become synonymous with black life in the United States have all but guaranteed the continuation of black social deficiency and thus making the notion of black success exceptional. Even when African Americans effectively engage in the electoral process, a right that many fought and died to achieve, they can still suffer gross forms of disenfranchisement. Not only have black people been forced to live on the negative side of most social indicators of well-being, but America has shown its ability to grow, expand, and develop with said inequity in tow. In Ferguson, there's a series of civic punishments, what I call civic punishments. And these are the kind of petty fines, penalties, summons to court that many of the working class, poor black and brown people in Ferguson have to endure. The state was making millions of dollars off of this process that penalized poor folk. That is, you get a ticket, it's an X amount, you're probably unable to pay it, you have to take off time to go and get a bail reduction, not a bail reduction, but a fine reduction, take off work, miss work, how many days off can you get, out of a job, can't pay the fine, warrant, jailable offense. This is how the municipal court system and fine structure in Ferguson is operating. And make no mistake about it, even though the news cameras covered this for days on end, shining a spotlight on policing agencies throughout Missouri, the Missouri state apparatus has continued to exercise violence against black and brown bodies even to this day. Doing things like the Ferguson PD right now, which is videotape, going back through all the videotape from stores and trying to look up who some of the activists were, who were disrupting some of the activity, the normalcy, the civic normalcy, and then leveling charges against them. This is going on right now. So just because we have a discussion on Ferguson doesn't mean that that particular struggle has been resolved. And as a historian, we're always in danger of trying to be too in the moment. And so it's very difficult to see how this is gonna end up, other than to say it's unlikely that the drastic changes that are being called for are actually going to be enacted. There's evidence to suggest that they're actually ramping up the violence and the bully tactics rather than trying to adhere to some of the reforms that's been proposed by many of the activists. So these civic punishments ensnare a lot of black residents in St. Louis and throughout Ferguson. But that's not the reason Mike Brown was killed. But they're part of that carceral continuum that we're talking about. Mike Brown was killed, why? Not for allegedly robbing a store, even though Jeff Roida wants us to think that that was the reason. And everybody know who Jeff Roida is? Jeff Roida is the head of the police union in St. Louis County. And he's basically the Missouri version or the St. Louis version of Lynch, Patrick Lynch from NYPD. The guy who was saying that there's blood on the hands. You remember that news clip? Y'all watch the news? No? There's blood on the hands of de Blasio for the two police officers who were ambushed in Brooklyn. So Jeff Roida wants us to think that that's the reason why Mike Brown was killed, but Mike Brown violated social etiquette. And that is, you know, he did not cower to Darren Wilson in that moment. And Darren Wilson used the "I was threatened" excuse to shoot this young man, kill this young man, and as I said earlier, got paid for it. And what do I mean by that? Before there was even a discussion of whether or not an indictment was going to be brought, there was already fundraising activity from so-called local citizens supporting the police and put upwards, the last time I checked, it was at 600,000. So this is a young officer, white officer, shoots an unarmed African-American, and then people come to his support. Right, that should give us some sense of how things are, not just in Missouri, not just in North Carolina, but throughout the country, and what it means, what black lives mean to the state. So Darren Wilson's badge of legal authority is what killed him. And perhaps it is bitter irony that Darren Wilson remains free while Mike Brown lay buried in Old St. Peter's Cemetery, which is next door to the segregated, racially and economically high school, Normandy High School, that he attended. So he's buried right next to the segregated high school that he went to. And when he graduated August 1st, he was killed August 9th, 8 days after graduation from high school. The assertions of Black Lives Mattering, where we're at now, and we have a local movement, BLM 413, Black Lives Matter 413, you'll hear about that as we go forward. The assertions of Black Lives Mattering and the reconceptualization of Black History Month as Black Futures Month, y'all up on that? Black Futures Month, y'all down with that? All right, some of y'all are. Some of y'all on the fence. We're trying to shake the hell out of the fence today. We're trying to shake the hell out of the fence. Because this is not a time, even though I have some wonderfully, wonderfully developed prose for you, this is not the time where we need to make the perfect argument to understand what's going on. All it takes is a set of eyes and ears, a heart, to understand the severity of what's happening to many of our young black and brown folk in this country. And the question is, what are we gonna do about it? So even if you don't understand anything that I say today, that does not absolve you from getting involved in this movement, period. It doesn't. Especially if you consider yourself a non-black person, or if you're white, does it matter that you don't feel the pressure that these young lives feel on a daily basis? You have work to do. We have work to do. And that work, to me, includes, in the broadest sense, an effort to dismantle a white racial logic that says white supremacy is normal. It's no accident that the Ku Klux Klan of Missouri was coming out to Darren Wilson's defense, or that police officers were criminalizing the protesters, calling for Darren Wilson to be brought to justice, and these police officers were wearing "I am Darren Wilson" bracelets. And they had to issue an order from top down telling them, don't show up to the protest site. If you're an officer, don't show up to the protest site with "I am Darren Wilson" wristbands on. So just because, you know, we haven't even paused, death doesn't even scare us anymore. That's the issue. Black deaths don't matter. And so the officers, they saw themselves in the role of victim just because people were calling for a judicial process to evaluate, an investigative process to evaluate what actually happened on August 9th, and they were victimized by that. And even locally, police union representatives in Northampton, as well as Holyoke, have written letters, public letters, basically criminalizing the local effort to stand in solidarity with Ferguson. So they feel under siege simply by us marching in the street. And so in that space, they occupy both the bully, the space of the bully, and the most fragile person in society. You can't have it both ways. So the Black Lives Mattering, it's an assertion. It's an assertion, but it's haunted by the punctuality of the question mark, which is to say, do Black Lives Matter? The assertion is not quite, it's confident for us, but society is unsure. And so just in the form of having to express and assert Black Lives Mattering is in and of itself an indictment of American society, right? A severe charge, those of us who, you know, think indictment is, you know, something else, a severe charge. It's asserted, but it's not guaranteed. A future that is asserted versus one that is expected. A future asserted versus a future that's expected. Black Impossibility understands that nostalgia is black bodily trauma, which is to say, nostalgia does not exist for black people. There are no old happy days. There are no time where everything was tranquil. Every decade is struggle. Every decade, despite, yes, some would you say, well, what about the rise of the middle class in the 1980s and all them black people that Ronald Reagan hired? Regardless of that, regardless of LeBron, President Obama, the most common condition has been one of suppression, experienced state violence, suspect citizenship. That's been the most common. And even now you have elected officials in the state houses of different states whose their peer groups help to disenfranchise them as elected officials. Meaning what? They can't get bills passed. How do they represent their constituency, et cetera? I refer you to a wonderful article, pretty long, in the New Republic called The New Racism, subtitled, This is How the Civil Rights Movement Ends, that just came out maybe 11 months ago or so, maybe less, that talks about how many of the advances of the civil rights generation are being eroded from within government. But the story that society wants us to know as young people is we're nothing if we don't vote. So here you go vote and say you get really deep into the electoral process. Now you want to run for office only to have your peers in elected office help to disenfranchise you. That's what that article is about. That's not on the nightly news. But that's one of the ways that civil society penalizes folk who are calling for transformative changes. That's one of the latest tools. And for every one of these meetings that we're having today, there's at least hundreds others that are telling you the exact opposite of everything we're talking about. So I want to make sure we have that understanding. Nostalgia, no, we don't have nostalgia. Mike Brown, Vondera Myers, Renisha McBride are the freshly faded reminders of community trauma, reminding us that civil society is unable to accept black people on their own terms and is incapable and unwilling to protect black humanity. If you look at the chants of the current movement, y'all know the chants from the movement? I got my hands on my head, please don't shoot me dead, right? That's one of the chants. Was y'all out there marching? No. Watching on TV? Hands up, don't shoot. And there's many others, I'm just giving you a snapshot. I can't breathe. Right? You can't get any more impossible than I can't breathe. And yet, no indictment for these officers. I think one personal anecdote is that my son knows all of the chants. He's 4 years old. When he sees officers, he starts singing the chants, which is dangerous for me because it just is a weird space. But imagine your four-year-old, needing to know the chance. Why does he know the chance? Because he's at the rally, because I'm at the rally. He comes to speaking engagements with me. So he knows this struggle from a different kind of perspective. But meanwhile, if he's a criminal. And that work was done strategically by people like Jeff Reuter and many people who support the police throughout Ferguson and St. Louis County. So this is where we're at right now, is returning back to moments of trauma that we locate throughout the Black experience in the United States. The current movement is calling into question all fibers of civil society. All fibers. This current movement is calling into question. Educational, financial, legal, cultural, religious, every single one. In fact, the sense of impossibility that we're talking about begs the question of the relevance and legitimacy of civil society and its institutions. And this is a movement that is necessarily Black-led, Black youth-led in many respects, multi-hued, transgenerational, unapologetically Black. This movement is in some respects a family reunion on the bow of a slave ship, Black bodies reimagined as sticks of dynamite, chained neck to foot, exploding across the Atlantic. The bow or intestines of the ship, is that a funeral procession? Stretching through modernity's social, structural, incentivized arrangements of power that exist in our current day. Those who fail to understand this are either numb to all feeling, completely resistant to the notion of Black liberatory vision, or are invested and enthusiastic defenders of the status quo, but I'm not talking about anybody here. Everybody's up on social media, right? Some people are saying a lot of social media is allowing these movements to be heard more broadly, allowing people to organize, but it also brought out an interesting phenomena called the troll. Everybody know what a troll is? Exactly. I hope none of y'all are trolls. But I just joined Twitter, but I'm bringing this up because a tweet that I put out while we were in Ferguson, somebody retweeted it today or yesterday. And the tweet was this: "Dear mainstream media, there is still a movement going on in hashtag Ferguson. Cameras have gone, but the people's struggle is still live." So that got retweeted. And then here come the trolls. So I started a Hug a Troll Day, and because these folks need hugs. But the handle at less gov more free, that's the handle, wrote to me at Doc10 and Hands Up United, "Nobody gives a fuck about Ferguson anymore. Darren Wilson took out the trash and should get a medal for that."
Wow.
Right. Hope they don't go to UMass. And then another one, at Doc10, "Is that struggle that you're talking about, does it involve one, shall I get a job? Or one, shall I get a job? Ha 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 ha." Right.
Oh my God.
So, there's still a movement going on in Ferguson. Cameras have gone, but the people's struggle is still alive. Elicited that kind of commentary. And there was just a couple that I could show you from the account, but regardless, we can continue to soldier on. Black Lives Matter, the movement that is nothing short of a full throttle reimagining of the social order along the lines of racial justice, instead of economic exploitation and gratuitous violence. I am not saying, however, that there is no point in living. Our policing agencies are all too ready and too busy to send us that message. But I don't intend to hold up the futile notion of inevitable progress, a kind of patriotism despite extermination. Rather, I want to use these killings as returning us to the bow of that ship to sit quietly in the cold, hard cell, in the dungeon, in the middle of the street with Mike, one shoe off and pierced for 4.5 hours. I want us to sit there and absorb all the shock, the trauma, the uneasiness, the hurt, and the seething anger. Are you there? Breathing deeply, inhaling, exhaling, imagining our liberation and our resistance. It's no accident that the bold and brilliant millennial activists united, the three sisters who started this organization out of Ferguson, have made up a hoodie that says, Asada taught me. Have y'all seen that hoodie?
Yeah.
I want to take us back to 1973 for a second and read you a communique from Sister Asada, writing from exile. Black brothers and black sisters, I want you to know that I love you, and I hope that somewhere in your hearts you have love for me. My name is Asada Shakur, slave name Joanne Chesimard, and I am a revolutionary, a black revolutionary. By that, I mean that I have declared war on all forces that have raped our women, castrated our men, and kept our babies empty belly. I have declared war on the rich who prosper in our poverty, the politicians who lie to us with smiling faces, and all the mindless, heartless robots who protect them and their property. I am a black revolutionary, and as such, I am a victim of all the wrath, hatred, and slander that America is capable of. Like all other black revolutionaries, America is trying to lynch me. I am a black revolutionary woman, and because of this, I have been charged with and accused of every alleged crime in which a woman was believed to have participated. The alleged crimes in which only men were supposedly involved, I have been accused of planning. They have plastered pictures allegedly to put me in post offices, airports, hotels, police cars, subways, banks, television, and newspapers. They have offered over $50,000 in rewards for my capture, and they have issued orders to shoot on sight and shoot to kill. And we should know the $50,000, this is in 1973. As of 2012, the bounty was doubled from this amount. It was it turned into $1 million, and now it's at $2 million and counting. And that was established in 2012. That's under Attorney General Eric Holder and under Black State Attorney General in the state of New Jersey named Aaron Ford, and the black president, just in case you keeping track. I'm a black revolutionary, and by definition, that makes me part of the Black Liberation Army. The pigs have used the newspapers and the TVs to paint the Black Liberation Army as vicious, brutal, mad dog criminals. They have called us gangsters and gun moles and have compared us to such characters as John Dillinger and Ma Barker. It must be clear to anyone who can think, see, or hear that we are the victims. The victims and not the criminals. And that was Asada Shakur's communique, July 4th, 1973. So I point these examples out and give us this language to think about and these names to think about so that we have a real appraisal of both the oppression and the resistance, but also the stakes that come with the resistance. And that's precisely why many people get in line with the status quo. It's because you are criminalized and ran through the mud, discredited, and not able to be seen as a victim. And so Asada Shakur is reminding us of this game that is being played. It's being played in Ferguson, New York, right, with Eric Garner selling the Lucy's. That became the reason he gets choked out. And then they want to criminalize him, his family, everyone else. They're criminalizing individuals and trying them long after they've already been put in the grave. We're still unsure about what we think about Mike Brown. The society doesn't want to wrap their arms around individuals like Mike Brown. And that's where we're at in terms of Ferguson and its persistent indictment of American society. And it's a movement, not a moment, that you all need to be a part of in some way. If you could walk, stand, you're a student, you're a worker, everybody has a responsibility to struggle on behalf of justice. So with that, I'll pause and take some questions if you will. Thank you.
Because recently, I don't know his post in the army, but he was during the apartheid days in South Africa. He was basically responsible of like orchestrating killings against a lot of black Africans. And I think it was about a week ago, they decided to like free him. I don't know if you're familiar with that story.
Yeah, I've heard it briefly, yep.
So maybe just get your thought on that, and also like the reconciliation after apartheid.
Yeah.
How that, I think for me personally, when that, the way I saw it is also like Black Lives Don't Matter, because here are all these people who were responsible for like basically killing all these Africans, and after apartheid, we're gonna forgive all of them when what they did is like unforgivable for killing such a individual.
Yeah. No, I mean, this is where we're at. Is truth itself a form of reparation? Mm. Right? Because what we're talking about is whether or not people could, one, stop the harm, two, repay victims in some way. And when you have so many lives massacred, what is the repayment? When do you stop the oppression and allow the healing to start? Does it come with just the truth being told? And what truths are told? I would argue that in the United States context, we haven't had a truth and reconciliation. We haven't had a broad discussion of what the truth is. We have had the reproduction of patriotism. We have had a narrative of racial progress. And so I'm trying to poke at that. And I think that, you know, the folks who are up in arms about that, and not everybody supported truth and reconciliation, but they believe that at least if the aggressors are honest about what's happening, maybe they could start to take some responsibility, right? But it didn't lead to a general overhaul in the racial status quo, in property ownership, in land ownership, right? But things have, you know, gotten better, so we're told. But, and clearly there's much more mobility than was, you know, in that particular, you know, time period. But it doesn't mean that you can't be killed. It doesn't mean that your life matters anymore. It just means that, you know, the government is making an effort to get ahead of it. And by, you know, weaving the narrative of progress into the national fabric, and thereby allowing us to get on with our lives. And so some people's trauma, though, is compounded by that move. Mm-hmm. You know, and so rather than it actually leading to some peace of mind, it actually reproduces the trauma. And so, you know, that's what I have to say about that.
Like, just some candid comments on like Al Sharpton, and if you think someone like that would do more harm than good in terms of their activism, what they're saying.
You think Al Sharpton is any worse than the U.S. military?
No, I just more so like, do you think his appeals to like the formal reform system and saying we need to make his appeals to Washington, do you think that does more harm than good?
All right, that's an easier question. because I'm not gonna blame, you know, one of the brothers, you know, that we connected with, and has been a leader from on the ground in Ferguson, Tef Poe, and some other folk in his crew said, this is not your dad's civil rights movement. So they were trying to make a statement about the distance between 1960s era, 70s era. And even though we use that term civil rights, and somehow Reverend Al was a part of that, Reverend Al was not a part of the civil rights movement, the heroic civil rights movement, but he's written into the history a little bit. Okay, so that being said, even though he has rubbed a lot of people the wrong way, I'm not blaming him for the conditions in Ferguson. So I want to make sure that we understand that. None of the black activists, even if they are middle class, bourgeois, Christian, church going, out of touch with the young people, I'm not blaming them for the conditions that were in Ferguson. Okay? The conditions in Ferguson are part of historic processes and a municipality structure, so that within St. Louis County, there's 82 municipalities. Every single one of them has their own court. Every single one of them has their own policing agencies. Those kind of things are archaic for our understanding of modern society. And they're also rooted in a kind of pioneer logic and allow people to hold on to power in some very concrete ways, which is why Jeff Roy, the police union rep, is on par with the governor of Missouri, Jay Nixon. Jay Nixon, the governor of Missouri, actually campaigns for Jeff Roida, not the other way around. Okay? And these are all Democrats, by the way. You think everybody in the South is Republican? It's not the case. So, but the question of seeking redress from the White House is, I think, is important, but it's not enough. This is not a top-down movement. This is a bottom-up movement. And so what people are saying, you know, the president convened a meeting with activists from Ferguson and people who are specialists and people who are intellectuals and scholars, a small group, and representatives from the Dream Defenders were there, representatives from MORE, Missourians for Reform and Empowerment, representatives from MAU were at the meeting. And so people go to the meeting because, yeah, the president asked for people to come and give their honest opinion. And to the degree that you can go in and be heard honestly, will tell you whether or not he's serious and sincere about the concern. We don't know what it's going to bring out. DOJ is investigating what's happened in Ferguson. But as we saw a few weeks ago, there was rumors that there wasn't going to be any formal charges brought. Okay? This movement is trying every effort, every single avenue, whether that's direct action protests, whether that's the formal work of getting a civilian oversight with subpoena power, law passed to where there are police killings, civilians are investigating, right? There's not that many of those operating, those kind of systems operating throughout the country. Out of 18,000 policing agencies in the United States, 17 of them from 2010 to the present, 17 out of 18,000 were under DOJ review. These include off the map kind of places like Albuquerque, New Mexico, which has a history of disappearing and killing people who are in police custody. Somehow, next thing you know, they were arrested, and then next thing you know, somehow they die. So DOJ is investigating them. DOJ is also investigating Florida. Just came down this week that in 2014, 346 inmates in the correctional institutions in Florida died in custody. 346 wow. In 1 year. Okay? Died in the DOC, Department of Corrections, custody. So the movement is flexible and nimble enough and attentive enough to know how to put pressure on different parts of society. Some of it is going to be in the streets. Some of it is going to be legislative. None of it is going to be sellout. None of it is going to undo the work that's been done to raise awareness around this issue. One of the beautiful things about Ferguson is that it put policing agencies under broad-based scrutiny, especially those in small-town USA, because we have Los Angeles, the LAPD, notorious. Oakland PD, notorious. Philadelphia PD, notorious. New Orleans PD, notorious. Right? Chicago PD, notorious. NYPD, notorious. We have those six or seven cities, they overshadow all the other policing agencies. So we never heard of Ferguson. We never thought about the little fiefdoms of power that exist there until this movement. So in many respects, we have this we owe this movement a lot of love and appreciation precisely for forcing the issue and not going back inside when everybody said it was time to go back inside. And no, not everyone is in agreement about the tactics and the strategy. This is a decentralized movement. And that's what scares the hell out of everybody. And so what they're doing is going ahead and criminalizing that movement, rather than trying to say, hey, what are your legitimate claims on this society? How are we gonna include you? How is your life gonna matter to a new sense of governance and civic participation throughout Missouri? They're not saying that. That argument is coming from civil society. You know, people who are intellectuals, legal aid folk, they're making that claim. Not the government, not the hierarchy. So to answer the question is to say, you're going to try everything at your disposal, which includes broad-based national solidarity as well as connections internationally. It's no accident that when Ferguson protesters were getting hit with tear gas, people from Palestine were sending messages saying, here's how you survive tear gas. People all over the world, in Brazil, in Mexico, were sending communiques of solidarity with the protests in Ferguson. So Ferguson became both internationalized and it became a verb at the same time. We have to thank this movement for that. Coming out of Ferguson, organizations like OBS, Organization for Black Struggle, which is on the ground with other groups trying to negotiate for drastic transformative changes in the governing structure in Missouri. This scares the power throughout Missouri. And that's, you know, that's a civil society strategy. So that's what's going on. So the idea is it's not just one effort. And even though we talk about police brutality, you know, we don't consider that a part of the carceral continuum that we're talking about. You know, the fact of executions happening, you know, in the top 15 executions, right? Meaning people sentenced to death and then executed. You know, counties in Missouri rank 9 and 10th on that list. All right, as the top 15 counties that execute people in this country. That has everything to do with Darren Wilson. That has everything to do with police oversight. That has everything to do with Mike Brown. And those two things are part and parcel. Those things are part and parcel of what this movement is about. It's a movement, it's a broad-based movement for justice. It's not narrow, it's not myopic. It's not fighting, you know, the old war, the last war, right? It's not trying to rehash old wounds. It's reminding people of the long-term struggle that we've been a part of. So that's a long, long way of answering your question, man. Thank you, though. Hands, any other hands, questions? Go ahead. Give me your name and speak loud so I can hear you, please.
My name is Justin. What do you think that we can do as a movement to prioritize the disenfranchisement and the stealing of black lives that intersect with other identities, like black women, black transgender people, black people living with disabilities?
So I want to refer everybody to the Black Lives Matter statement. You know, have you read the Black Lives Matter statement? Those of us, raise our hands. Because in the Black Lives Matter statement, even though I said it has all the ingredients for a new social order, it has specific ingredients along the lines of what you mentioned, right? So again, this is a broad-based, broad-minded movement. It's not myopic, It's not trying to explicitly say narrowly nationalistic, right? Which is a signal to those of us on the left, the black radical left, who have an affinity, or perhaps in one day were black nationalists. They said, we're not gonna be narrow nationalists. So that means that even people within the movement, long distant runners in the movement, have to recalibrate and reappraise what it means to be in this particular movement, in this particular future that's being called for. So Black Lives Matter covers the gamut of trans people, queer people, differently able. It's named in there, but it's also putting that on the same register with trying to protect Asala Shakur, making sure we understand political prisoners. The United States government technically doesn't recognize political prisoners. We call them political prisoners from the movement. People like Mumia Abu-Jamal, right? Russell Maroon Schultz, Leonard Peltier, many, many others. David Gilbert. Point is that this is a redefinition of what society is. That's what's being called for, and that's why, that's part of the reason why people, those folks are being criminalized. Those people who articulate Black Lives Matter, even locally, are being criminalized. So, I want to speak frankly about this we, because I want to make sure we understand who the we is. And I know that was grammatically incorrect. It's okay. We in Commonwealth College, you gotta be careful. He said, we is. Yeah. As I mentioned in the talk, is black led. Is white society on the grassroots level prepared, able to digest, ready for black leadership? What does that look like? Because most people, I teach at Hampshire College, where ally, 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 ally is the conversation for people who are not people of color. Okay? How can I be an ally? And so my answer is, are you on the bow of the ship with us? Do you see yourself in the bow of the ship? Face at the bottom of the well, as Derek Bell used to say, has a book titled that. I mean, allyship ends when oneness begins. So therefore, if you see yourself as this is not my struggle, then allyship is for you. Yeah. Right? And so I want to push beyond, and I don't know what it is, but I know that we need more than a discussion of being an ally, because that allows people to check in and check out. And it doesn't hold people accountable. And it allows people to pat themselves on the back for showing up to a meeting or a lecture by Professor Tinson. And they think that they actually done the work. But they fail to realize that people like Grace Lee Boggs existed. Exist, excuse me. Ancestors protect me. People like W.B. Du Bois. People like C.L.R. James, who lived every waking hour for this question of racial justice, and lived a long time, 89 years old, 93 years old, 99 and counting for Grace Lee. She watched a documentary called American Revolutionary about the life of Grace Lee Boggs, and read her work, and why she's so important to black liberation struggle, even though she's a Chinese American. Know the history of Yuri Kochiyama, Japanese American, solidarity with black struggle, lifetime of activism, never abandoned principles, right? If you can pattern yourself after those examples, that's when we start patting ourselves on the back. All right, but as I've said before, not here but elsewhere, this is not a movement that you graduate from, that you put on your resume as community engagement and civic activism, or whatever the little thing you got to do outside the classroom that they call it here. We call them advanced learning activities. This is not a movement for advanced learning activities, okay? This is lifetime struggle. This is recalibration of who you think you are in relationship to questions of citizenship and democracy. Who do you think you are in this country? And how do you know who you are in this country? That's the question that this movement is pushing us to really engage. So we have to be serious. And the people that are named are serious. Asad Shakur, serious. Not playing around. So therefore, if that's you, then that's the we. If it's not, then you need to practice on your you know, proximity to the movement. Like, what's happening? What are you doing? Right? And you people say, okay, well, Organization for Black Struggle, are there white members? Not that I know of. Okay? People of color led, over 30 years old, based in St. Louis. Okay? But you have an organization like MORE, Missourians Organizing for Reform and Empowerment, and those folk were leading a lot of the bail fund campaigns. They put together some proposals for drastic changes in the fine structure, the fee structure in St. Louis County. And those things are being debated as we are here right now. And the police union representative has been attending those meetings so that he could disrupt the conversation and pivot it back towards defending the police's right to operate with impunity. The police aren't leading this movement because they don't want to be transparent. No policing agency, as a full policing agency, has come out and said, we support Black Lives Matter. You have had a chief or two, Pittsburgh, I believe, Richmond, California, the chief came out to the protesters, held up a Black Lives Matter sign while he was in uniform. But that's two, right? 18,000 police forces and two chiefs said something about Black Lives Matter that we know about. So we're not waiting on them to tell us when to move, what to ask for, what to demand, but we know that they've been doing everything to continue business as usual, and because they've continued business as usual, it means more black bodies and brown bodies are gonna die. It means that white vigilantism is gonna continue, and it means that nobody's gonna be brought to justice. Yes, you're saying the Michael Dunn, killer of Jordan Davis, got brought to justice. Yes, those crooked cops in New Orleans who shot people as they were looking for help during Hurricane Katrina got brought to justice. But I want to make no mistake about it. We're also not just about swelling up the prison industrial complex. So this is a very deep and critical movement. And a lot of the things are still being wrestled with because, yes, I'm a prison abolitionist, so what does that mean when we're seeking justice, right, for Mike Brown? And that's a question that the movement has to answer for itself. And not everybody is in agreement on that. And just because you lock somebody up doesn't mean that it gives you peace for losing your 18-year-old. Even if you pay somebody, they win in a wrongful death suit. So the point is that this is a nuanced thing. This is not just, you know, people in the street, you know, just making noise because they don't have anything else to do or doing something so that they could feel like a part of something because when I was in college, we shut down the freeway. No, this is broad-based, it's gonna continue whether or not folks who are not directly affected get involved. Whether or not folks get involved, the movement is gonna continue, right? Because this is about self-preservation. It's about literally self-preservation. And so that's where we're at right now in terms of just understanding all the different points. And also, I would also just take this time to talk about this issue of you know, why people aren't up in arms about black-on-black crime. I'm surprised none of y'all hit me with that one yet. And the reason is because we already been addressing that. Simple and plain. Not only that, but vigilante and police violence, death by COs, corrections officers, as well as black and black violence, that is two sides of the same coin called white supremacy, settler capitalism, penal democracy. That's producing the same, you know, one different people are carrying it out, same result. The conditions that lead to gang warfare are managed by the state. So when we throw this term out, like, why y'all not upset about black on crime and violence and murders? It misses that point, but it also misses the point that most murders are same race, right? That's been verified and studied. So it's the proximity question. And so the point is that that's being addressed too. You know, that is being addressed. But people just want to use that as a red herring and say, well, don't look at me. Don't look at the police when you have all this violence in Chicago. You see all those people who died 2 years ago, last year, yesterday. Don't come to me talking about the police. But we're going to talk about the police because they're part of that problem too. So I want to get some more questions. I'm sorry. Give me your name, please.
Annika.
Cool.
Thank you for all the great words you've said so far. So my question is, everybody wants to call themselves an activist. We see students out there every color protesting, but what's the next step to take, no matter what you classify yourself as, to become not just an ally, but to become one with the movement? What do you do to go beyond just protesting?
A lot. I know. But I'm just reaching out to my comrade to see if she wants to say something before she got to leave. Did you want to expound on that? It'll be helpful.
Sure.
Sorry to put you on the spot.
Can you get up so people can hear you?
Or just yell out however you want to do it. However you want to do it.
Yeah, so I'm Vanessa, and I'm one of the organizers with BLM 413, the local chapter of Black Lives Matter that was formed after this trip to Ferguson. I think what Chris just spoke about, I feel like that was kind of touched on, but I think, I guess I briefly talk about like the importance of this movement being not only primarily Black-led, but the term Black Lives Matter was started by three Black women, so also by young Black and brown women. And for some of us who face police violence every day, the one statistic that I always throw out that I'll mention again right now was that every 28 hours a Black person was killed by police or vigilantes in the United States. But as of yesterday, and I'm not sure how many of these people were white and how many of them were Black, 109 people had been killed in this country by police as of yesterday for the year. So I have a feeling that statistic has gone up a lot this year. So I don't even know actually what this term like activist like means anymore. Like, I like the term organizer because like what was just spoken about in the movement being decentralized, I think is really important, and nobody's looking to kind of one leader. People are organizing together and people are building together. So, I don't know. I think like, again, I would say that like a lot of people don't, I guess everyone does like have a choice. Like Black people can like lock themselves in their house forever or choose to go out and live. And if you choose to go out and live, I think for a majority of Black and brown people, that means fighting back. So I will say that. I will also use this time very briefly to encourage you all to check out the Black Lives Matter 413 Facebook page because that's a really good way to stay connected with what we're doing. And the local chapter is predominantly Black and brown people. It's all Black and brown people who are leading the movement and very intentionally reaching out to what we want our help to look like from white allies and putting a lot of thought and having a lot of conversation about what white allyship looks like to this movement, to us, locally. because it's really important that the people who are most affected by these issues, not just of being shot every day, but of mass incarceration, but of the violence of poverty, but of the violence of discrimination and inadequate education and constant policing in every level of education from the time children enter school. We're thinking about all of those things, and we're going to have a different response. So I would encourage everyone to check out the BLM 413 Facebook page. And also say that this Friday, several of us who went to Ferguson, young black organizers, are doing a panel at Hampshire from 3 to 5 p.m. And you're all welcome to come to that and continue the conversation. And I will also throw out a little kind of save the date, because the 21st this year is 50 years since Malcolm X was assassinated, and we're going to be having a major action there. And so all color allies and organizers and activists and revolutionaries are welcome to come, and artists and humans are welcome to come and support at this time. There will be information closer to the date. So thanks.
Thanks, Bert. Other questions? Now ready to go. Got hot in here. Go ahead.
I don't want to prevent anyone else from asking a question, but I was moved by a lot of what you said, and I was been thinking a lot about what you said about history, and I'm wondering whether you could talk more about what you see as the significance of shifting from Black History Month to Black Teachers Month, and how that relates to what I see as a really powerful, you're poking at the narrative of progress. You're doing it in a very powerful way of asking us instead to make these traumatic, right, connections to the past, right, and the bowel of the slaveship. So I'm wondering if you can talk more about what you see as the role of history in our thinking about struggle and how to how to conceptualize that in ways that don't create false narratives of progress, but also don't kind of make history meaningless.
Right. I think history is one of my favorite weapons, but that's because I'm under the tutelage of people like John Bracy and Ernest Allen, Mike Delwell, and many others directly connected to movement in their day. And during the repression of black activism, black radical activism in the 60s and 70s, the refuge was universities for a lot of folks. But they brought all that movement memory to the spaces of the academy, and then began to identify the academy as a site of contestation, as a site to struggle against, not just to be a part of. So I'm in that tradition. And then intellectually, people from Walter Rodney, James, as I mentioned, and many others, remind us of the importance of history in social struggle. And again, they're criminalized for it. So it comes with great risk. I've said before that I'm not sure that you can call yourself an activist unless you have committed to learning the history of that which you're organizing around. Many people just sign up for something, but they don't want to learn the history of what it is they're organizing around. Or they're in it for themselves. And so rather than committing themselves to a deep, broad understanding of how we got to this moment, it's more about self-reference and pleasure and thrill-seeking and things of that nature. So I want to poke at that and name that. But I also want to talk specifically briefly about just some of the historic issues that come up for those of us who do study history that make Ferguson what Ferguson is. And one of the things that is not talked about very often is the history of racial and educational segregation in Ferguson as a part of government policy in the 1950s to really, suburbanize certain parts of Missouri. And this happened across the country. But St. Louis also has a particular history of that. and also a particular history of not only suburbanization, but suburbanization at the expense of the ghetto. And that is to say, not only were ghettos left behind, people in them left behind, but in many cases, public housing was absolutely demolished, left to deteriorate in St. Louis. So when we think about the history that Mike Brown walked into, it's a history that includes zoning and redlining and restrictive covenants and things that, you know, worry the hell out of historians, because now we gotta go and read all those mortgages. But the point is that that's part of the entanglement, if you will, the historical entanglement that led to Ferguson being most recently that part heavily occupied by black working class people. You know, this has everything to do with suburbanization, patterns of suburbanization throughout Missouri. And because you have that residential segregation, you're gonna have educational segregation, both in terms of monies allocated to schools and also who attends the public schools. And obviously, as we know throughout the country, if you're in a wealthy district of homeowners, that local school is gonna be better funded than the one that gets most of its money from the state. And so that's the pattern in Springfield, that's the pattern in Holyoke, those are the patterns of urban America. And so in many respects, this is a historic question of urban America, urbanization, and racial segregation through housing and economic policy, you know. So in terms of just things that we could study, it's certainly ample, there's ample evidence there to show the kind of historic background, the soil, ingredients, whatever you want to call it, that led to an all-white police force policing a pretty much black community. But that 15 years ago, that same community had a lot of working class white people there. So, you know, this is part of the patterns in American society, but urbanization and suburbanization are definitely part of it.
I would just like say quickly, like, that the Asada taught me shirts, that one of the chants that people chant in Ferguson and all over the country and people start with and end with is a chant made out of words that Asada wrote in her autobiography, and we carry that everywhere. And so this movement that is predominantly youth-led, like, we see this as not like some new revolution or some new struggle for black liberation, but the continuum that you mentioned, but a continuing and a picking up of resistance and struggle for over 500 years of colonial like structures. So it's nothing new. So we read Asada and we study Nat Turner as excitedly as we listen to Tef Poe's new music and connect with the Dream Defenders. So I would say that.
Yeah. So all of you folks who study in history in the room, you know, push the professor on these questions, you know, of redlining, zoning, housing segregation, deteriorating public housing. That's part of what made St. Louis St. Louis, you know, and also, you know, parts of Massachusetts, Lowell, you know, Holyoke, as I mentioned. I mean, all cities are not immune to this. This is a pattern in American society. Mm-hmm. Anyone over here? Oh, hey, what's up?
I have a question. I know that a lot of times, you know, there's the phenomenon where something happens and then you start hearing about all these other cases of this similar thing happening. And I hear the once every 28 hours, a person of color is killed by somebody. And also what was said today, that, you know, maybe that number is kind of going up. Does that seem like is that happening more? Are we hearing about it more? What do you think's going on there? Do you have any thoughts on that? Like, were people of color being targeted and just killed as with as much impudence in the 90s?
Yes.
And so are we just hearing about it more? But it's been happening at the same rate.
Yeah, different, I don't know about the same rate, because that number refers to what's happened since 2010. This is
right.
Coming out from the Malcolm X grassroots movement,
right,
who gave that language to the movement of every 28 hours. That's coming from MXG, and that's a recent study.
Right.
Right. And it's not longitudinal in the sense that it doesn't go back into the 70s and look at the periods that way. So I don't want to say every 28 hours was happening in the 90s. Doesn't mean, though, that aggressive policing and jailing and sentencing patterns hadn't been meted out, you know, across the urban landscape with ferocity in the 1980s and 90s. I'm from Los Angeles. The battle ram, you know, as a part of the war on drugs. This was a literal one-man vehicle that could drive up on any surface and had a, you know, elongated arm that literally ran up in houses. So when we're talking about militarism, we're talking about the carceral continuum, we're talking about exposure to violence, we're talking about hyper-visibility, racialization by the police. That is nothing new. Sure. What we're talking about now is also a part of kind of a reorganizing of the state such that black lives are being rendered, again, disposable property. And so, you know, instead of going through the gamut of things that you could do to say either in confrontation, protect yourself, or in the 90s, there were fist fights with police. That was regular. Now it's just, we're gonna shoot you. And so it's part of a long history of violence that black bodies have suffered in this country for since the beginning, arguably. You know, so
I feel like you hear names like, you know, Amadou Diallo, or, you know, like over the years you hear names every now and then, but now it's absolutely, like, it's a name like every day.
But that's,
I mean, just because we didn't know about it doesn't mean it wasn't happening.
That's when, yeah.
And every single community has these stories.
Yeah.
Of you know, people's lives lost in police custody or shot by police in normal, otherwise normal traffic stop. Even police, I'm just learning those stories locally of police inciting riots and then, you know, criminalizing everybody in their neighborhood for attacking the police. And so, and I use that term riot because it is a police riot, even though they use our rebellions, they use that as a riot. But I'm saying, you know, folks provoking. There's never been a time, to my knowledge, where broad-based transparency in terms of how community and police respond to one another and how police, you know, make themselves available, transparent, that's been the rule. You know, it's always been an exception. And so growing up, that was our circumstance. A regular traffic stop could end up in cuffs in the back of the car. You did nothing wrong. All those things are part of this carceral continuum. And folks have shown that the more negative interactions you have with police, the less civically engaged you're going to be. And so that correlation is indisputable at any given time.
I just want to just like thank social media. I think when I hear you, like, your statement about, like, by my way, my name is Khalil, and I hear your statement about, like, it's going on and on and on and on. I think it has never stopped since lynching. I mean, the method has to change. I mean, when they lynched us, left us out there for hours to instill that fear, and you look at what happened with Mike Brown, yeah, being left out there for 4.5 hours, and then being put in the back of a pickup truck, you know, couldn't even have the honors enough to get an ambulance,
right? Right.
You know, so it's social media has been playing a big role and like how we are able to project our own media, you know, and share it, you know. So that's why we hear a lot more, especially if you're on any kind of social media, it's real big. And I just wanted to like touch on, like, you know, what the young lady was saying about, like, how can we get involved? And it's sad to say, but like silence is violence. And like getting involved, it's like you have to find your role, you know. Literally, you gotta ask yourself, which side are you on?
Right.
You know, because if you're not doing anything, then you're actually part of that problem. You know, so finding your role in this, you know, is major. And I'd like to just thank you for everything that you share, because the reality of freedom is that I strongly believe that once black people are free, that all people will be free. You know, I come to the sense where sometimes I feel like Jesus must have been black, because he was oppressed like none other, you know. And so it's something that's continuously going on, and finding your role. And there is, even though BLM 413 is, you know, a black movement by black youth, there is a coalition that is starting. And I have an email for people that want to get involved that are white allies. So I'll kind of share that now. It's TIW Solidarity Looks Like 413 at gmail.com. And it's a beautiful sister named Rachel, who's kind of put this coalition together to kind of have those engagements of like, what does white allies look like?
You mean the email again? Okay. TIW Solidarity Looks Like. Basically, this is what solidarity looks like, but the first three are initial. TIW, all caps. Solidarity Looks Like 413 at gmail.com. Oh, Rachel, Rubens. That's Rubens' people. So there's
you send it to them and then you're under the list.
I also want you to put in your notes to go to the Organization for Black Struggle website, OBS-on-the-move. Constantly updated, and so that you can read the concrete demands of the movement, because BLM, Black Lives Matter, is giving us the general soul and context of what's being called for and the new vision. But there's some on the ground things that are happening in Ferguson that we need to know about. And this organization is literally at the heart of it. OBS, Organization for Black Struggle, OBS-onthemove.org. All right, so make sure you check that out. There's constant updates. You can get links to that. You can hear our show Friday, 6 o'clock here at WMUA, streaming live on the internet as well, WMUA.org. But this is a movement that we have to make sure we really deeply understand and develop affinity with and join if it's for you. But know that if you hate, you're going to get rolled on. So as long as you know that, because this, you know, we're not stopping. This movement is about our lives, and anybody who wants to disrespect that or discredit that, that's when you're going to bring out a different side of these people, you know what I'm saying, of us. Always nonviolent, but always aggressive. I shouldn't say always nonviolent. We might have to, you know, show a little strength, but it's all good. Anyway, I enjoyed being with you today. And I'm at Doc10 on Twitter, DAHKTIN. You can also email ctinson@hampshire.edu. It's been a pleasure. Let's keep the movement moving.